Good evening. Let me invite you to take your Bible and turn with me to 1 Timothy chapter 5, verse 17. 1 Timothy chapter 5, verse 17. Last week, it was secret church style, and so that meant a number of chapters that we covered in this particular book. And so tonight, we're only going to look at 8 verses, the remainder of chapter 5, and still a number of issues, important issues that we want to look at in God's Word tonight. 1 Timothy chapter 5, verse 17, if you're there, let me invite you to read along with me as I read God's Word to us. Paul says, "Let the elders who rule well be considered worthy of double honor, especially those who labor in preaching and teaching. For the Scripture says, 'You shall not muzzle an ox when it treads out the grain, and the laborer deserves his wages.' Do not admit a charge against an elder except on the evidence of 2 or 3 witnesses. As for those who persist in sin, rebuke them in the presence of all, so that the rest may stand in fear. In the presence of God, and of Christ Jesus, and of the elect angels, I charge you to keep these rules without prejudging, doing nothing from partiality. Do not be hasty in the laying on of hands, nor take part in the sin of others. Keep yourself pure. No longer drink only water, but use a little wine for your stomach and your frequent ailments. The sins of some men are conspicuous, going before them to judgment, but the sins of others appear later. So also, good works are conspicuous, and even those that are not cannot remain hidden." Let's pray together. Father in heaven, we are privileged tonight to be able to even open your word and to read of you and to read of your instructions to us. And so, Father, tonight we begin by praising you for speaking to us, for calling us to yourself. And we pray that as we open your word tonight, we ask that you would help us to understand. And we pray that by your Spirit, you would help us to obey. For the glory of your name and for the glory of Christ, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Now, if you are perhaps visiting with us and maybe wondering why it is that we are looking at these particular verses tonight, it is because we naturally left off last time at verse 16. Very often when I say that, because very often when money is the subject of a sermon, particularly pastor compensation, people assume sometimes that there is some kind of motivation behind the message, that there's some kind of crisis, or maybe there's some kind of perceived need on behalf of the church. But I'm happy to say tonight, as we even open the Word of God tonight, I'm happy to say there's no such need, there's no such crisis. I can't tell you, and I know I speak on behalf of more than just myself, but leaders in this church, I can't tell you how grateful I am to you, to the Church of Brook Hills, for the way that you give and the way that you honor and the way that you support. And so I just want to establish that from the very outset, that this is no plea for money or anything along those lines. It's funny, I was preparing this particular part of this message, even on the financial side, in verses 17 and 18 earlier this week. It was Thursday, and a lot of times I'll go to a coffee shop or something like that to kind of get away and just be able to kind of work through the remainder of the outline, for example. And so I was there this Thursday, and I was working on this section about double honor and so forth. And on 2 different occasions, as I was working, there were people from Brook Hills who apparently had come in just very quickly. And twice, about 2 or 3 hours apart, someone just laid a gift card, a Starbucks gift card, right there on the couch and just walked away. And I don't know if that was just to kind of freak me out because I was preparing this part, you know, or whatever, maybe the illustration material, whatever, I don't know. But the moral of the story is twofold. One, the people of Brook Hills are extremely generous. And 2, always prepare your sermons at Starbucks. And so, but I was just really encouraged, you know. And again, there's no plea, it's well taken care of. And so I just wanted to be clear from the outset what we are doing tonight in the text. And so, with that in mind, I want to kind of reset the stage for us as we look at verses 17 through 25, because there are a number of issues, and they may appear disconnected. In fact, a lot of really from about chapter 3 on in 1 Timothy, Paul seems to go in a lot of different places. And so what I want to do is I want to kind of bring us back to what I think really sets the stage for chapters 4, 5, and 6 in the at the end of chapter 3, verses 14 through 16. So if you would, flip back there to those particular verses. It's the verses really that kind of establish us even going up to this point and then coming out of it. So chapter 3, verses 14 through 16. What I want to try to show you very quickly as we get into the text is that I really think that everything that Paul is going to say in chapters 4, 5, and 6 flows out of this idea of the church as the household of God, the church of the living God, the pillar and buttress of truth. And so he makes that statement and the confession that the church holds, the gospel, there in verses 15 and 16. And then he proceeds to kind of unpack that and say, what does that look like in leadership? What does that look like in a lot of different areas? So look, if you would, again, verse 15. He said, if I delay, you may know how one ought to behave in the household of God. The implication is that we don't know how to behave in the household of God. In other words, it's not just good enough to kind of go on our own natural wisdom. We need instruction. We need someone to tell us how we ought to behave in the household of God, which is the church of the living God, a pillar and buttress of truth. And what truth is it that the church is a pillar and buttress of? Well, verse 16, great indeed, we confess, is the mystery of godliness. And so he proceeds to talk about the gospel. He was manifested, speaking of Jesus, he was manifested in the flesh. He was vindicated by the Spirit in his resurrection. He was seen by angels, proclaimed among the nations, believed on in the world, and taken up in glory. And so I think Paul now, as he proceeds from there, unpacks kind of this idea. If I could kind of sum up verses 15 and 16, it would be simply this, that the gospel should be on display in the church. That the gospel, it's not in your notes, but the gospel should be on display in the church. Not only in what we believe, we certainly confess the gospel and believe the gospel, but not only in what we believe, but also in how we behave. That there ought to be something that is radically different in the church, in the way that we believe and in the way that we behave apart from the world. And then Paul begins to kind of unpack that. I want you to just notice that. And so we're going to kind of just glide over these because we covered these last week, but it sets the stage for tonight. Notice he says, based on that idea that there ought to be a distinction between the church and the world, the way that the church behaves and the way that the world behaves, Paul says the leaders ought to be different. Church leaders ought to be different from worldly leaders. And that's why he commends Timothy at the end of chapter 4. He says, watch your life and watch your doctrine, in chapter 4, verse 16. In the very same way, our relationships ought to be different than worldly relationships. And so he said in chapter 5, don't rebuke an older man, but encourage him as you would a father. Treat younger men like brothers, older women like mothers, younger women like sisters in all purity. In the very same way, it ought to flesh itself out in the way that we relate to widows. We looked at that extensively last week. And so the world naturally cast aside those that are weak, those that are poor, those that can be easily overlooked. The church is not to be that. The church is to embrace them. The church is to take care of them. The church is to esteem them very highly. And the very same thing when we come to chapter 5, verses 17 and following, Paul says that the relationship, and this is where we're going tonight, that the relationship between those that lead and those that are led ought to be different. It ought to look different in the church than it does in the world. That in the church, the gospel ought to be on display. Think about it in your own experience, your own life. The dynamics of, for example, the workplace. And think about the dynamics that exist between those that are leading in the secular workplace, whatever that is, and those that are being led typically. I mean, you think about all the things, the destructive gossip that is normally existent, the suspicion, favoritism, cutthroat mentalities, injustice, harsh leadership, impatience, bitterness. All of these things are the norm out there. But Paul says they ought not be the norm in here. That we ought to expect, these things in secular organizations. We ought to expect these things in government. But the church of the living God, the household of God, the pillar and the buttress of truth, the church ought to get these things right. There ought to be a difference, in other words, in the way that we, the elders, care for the body and the way that the body cares for elders. There ought to be a difference in the way that we care and the way that we see care expressed out there. Why? Because God intends for the church, for people to look into the church and to see the glory of the glory of God expressed in the gospel of God as the gospel stamps everything that we do. It stamps every relationship, every dynamic, every way that we relate one to another. And so what I want to do tonight is I want to kind of group all four of these instructions that I think we see in chapter 5, verses 17 through 25, under that umbrella of care. And we're going to talk about care for elders and care for the church. Really two different things there. And you'll notice, by the way, as we proceed through this sermon, that there is a lot of a two-way street. It's not just how the congregation should care for elders, but also how the elders are responsible to the church, how they are accountable to the church. And so there's a two-way street. But we're going to talk about two ways that the congregation should care for elders and two ways that the elders ought to be accountable to the body of Christ, and then kind of give at the end two motivations, two keys, how we can carry this out. So let's look tonight, first of all, the ways that we care. Notice first, we honor faithful elders. We honor faithful elders with generous provision. We demonstrate the power of the gospel, the glory of God, in the way that we honor faithful elders with generous provision. Look at verse 17. Let the elders who rule well be considered worthy of double honor, especially those who labor in preaching and teaching. The expression double honor there really is the key to understanding verse 17. Now, the problem with that is that Paul never ever uses that expression in any other writings of his. And so it's a unique expression, double honor, that we don't find anywhere else in Paul's writings. And so it kind of leaves us kind of scratching our heads, and commentators all over the place. What does it mean for the church to show double honor to those that rule well, especially in preaching and teaching? Well, I think the best thing that we can do then, with not explicit parallels, is to simply look at the context. And I think the context suggests two ways in which the body of Christ cares for elders. The two ways that the body of Christ honors elders. First of all, honor, a double honor, involves respect. It involves respect. You say, well, where do you get that? Well, look at the immediate context. Look at chapter 6, verse 1. I think it's a great place. You may want to jot some of these verses down. I'll give you two or three here. 1 Timothy chapter 6, verse 1, and you'll see that this idea of honor, at the very least, it involves respect. Notice what he says. Let all who are under a yoke as slaves regard their own masters as worthy of all honor. So we're going to talk about the financial side in a minute, but at the very least, it involves respect. Clearly, slaves were not intended to pay back their masters in a financial way. In fact, most of them, the vast majority of them, would not have had the means to do that. And so Paul is indicating here that there is a sense of gratitude, a sense of appreciation that is involved in this idea of honor. The same thing down in chapter 6, verse 16. Notice what he says down there, and this time in reference to God, who alone has immortality, who dwells in unapproachable light, whom no one has ever seen or can see, to him be honor and eternal dominion. Amen. Again, the idea of honor, appreciation, gratitude, respect toward God. And so, at the very least, congregations, for those that, we're going to unpack this in a minute, for those that rule well, labor in preaching and teaching, there ought to be from the congregation an esteeming, an honoring, a respect, a gratitude that is prevalent. You say, well, where do you kind of get that? Notice, I want to give you one other verse. I think it's an excellent, I think, commentary on these verses. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verses 12 through 13. If you want a good, I think, verse that kind of would exemplify, I think, the principle here in 5:17, it would be 1 Thessalonians 5, 12 through 13, where Paul says, "We ask you, brothers, to respect those who labor among you and are over you in the Lord and admonish you, and to esteem them very highly in love because of their work." To esteem them very highly in love because of their work. And so, the idea of double honor, I think initially it at least includes the idea of respect, but I think it also includes the idea of pay. of compensation includes the idea of pay or compensation. You say, well, where do you see that? Look, if you would, in verse 18. Look at verse 18. Notice the word for there. So Paul, what he's doing is he's giving us the basis in verse 18 for what he has just said in verse 17. Let the elders who rule well, he says, be considered worthy of double honor. And then verse 18, for the scripture says, you shall not muzzle an ox when it treads out the grain, and the laborer deserves his wages. So clearly, respect is involved, but also in this particular case, I think he's talking about those that would give themselves, you know, full-time in a sense or part-time in a sense to the ministry of preaching and teaching. Obviously, there were occasions in the New Testament. It's not where, you know, you have to be paid. There were occasions where Paul worked, and there were occasions where Paul didn't work. I mean, look at 1 Corinthians chapter 9 if you want to kind of investigate that on your own. And so it's not that it has to be, but it certainly can be. Those that the church has recognized and those that give themselves to that, there is then the idea of the laborer indeed deserves his wages. Now, it still begs the question, though, doesn't it? What does he mean by double honor? I mean, when it comes to just the final analysis, well, what does it mean to pay someone in a way such that there is double honor? Well, commentators are all over the place on this, but here's what one person said. Does double honor, is it double someone else who did not do as well, who does not rule as well? Doubtful. Is it double what the widows get? Probably not what Paul intends, but is it double what from the church down the road? Or my favorite, is it double what he got last year? I mean, who knows, you know? Probably not. I can't make any case whatsoever that is the case here, right? So I don't think Paul really, in the final analysis, Paul is not being prescriptive here. He's not telling us exactly what we should do and how we should handle things. I don't think that Paul is indicating in any sense extravagance. I don't think he's saying that we should pay people that labor in preaching and teaching in an extravagant fashion. In fact, he's going to warn against some of those ideas in chapter 6. I do think, though, the expression double honor indicates that there should be generosity on the people of God. And so whatever that looks like, and there's certainly, we can delve into that, but I think it at least includes the idea of generosity. You know, there are some, I've heard, there's a saying that some of you perhaps have heard that is clearly not what is being intended here, but I've heard it on a number of occasions, not here, but regarding pastor pay, congregations or churches say, Lord, you keep him humble, we'll keep him poor. I don't think that's what Paul certainly is intending. In fact, I think that's antithetical to what Paul is saying here. We all know, don't we? I mean, or most of us know, of cases where pastors and maybe their families are abused in this regard. It's not the case here, and I praise God for that. But there are many brothers who labor and who are not really given the wages that they deserve. And that's troublesome in a couple of ways. One, it simply violates verse 18 where Paul is calling for a basic sense of fairness. That if a laborer is laboring, and he quotes Jesus here from Luke chapter 10 verse 7, or Matthew chapter 10 verse 10, he is saying the laborer deserves his wages. And even brings up Deuteronomy chapter 25, verse 4, where he says, you know, the ox, as he treads out the grain, is at least allowed to eat as he goes along and as he labors. And Paul is citing that verse, just reminds, if we would treat animals that way, surely we would treat those that are human and that labor among us, surely we would treat them in a better way than that, or at least as good as that. So I think it violates a basic principle of fairness, but not only that, and I know churches don't necessarily intend to do this, they don't overtly think this way, but it says something not only about how much they view how much they value their own possessions, it says something about how little they value the ministry of the word. When churches withhold from pastors in an excessive way, and they're not fair to them. They're not just wronging a pastor. They are doing that. But they are also communicating to that church and to the outside world how little they think of the ministry of the Word of God. And so it seems like a kind of a trivial matter, but like all matters of money in the Bible, it really goes far beyond dollars and cents and goes very to the heart. And so I praise God again for a church that values the Word of God, esteems the ministry of the Word, and then as an expression of that, is generous to those who labor and preach in preaching and teaching. And so it involves the idea of respect. It includes the idea of pay. But I want you to notice, and this is where that two-way street thing comes in, that this is not automatic, that there is not an entitlement based upon position or background or anything like that. There are conditions that Paul lays down as to who is worthy of double honor. He again lays down two, and they're very closely related. First of all, he says they must rule well in the church. They must rule well in the church. Now, we have to be careful here. What does Paul mean when he says they must rule well in the church? I think we might get the wrong idea, the wrong impression from the idea of rule well in the church. Because when we use that word rule, we sometimes think in a heavy-handed kind of way. But I want you to maybe jot these verses down. He uses this very same word in 1 Timothy chapter 3, verse 4, verse 5, and verse 12. 1 Timothy chapter 3, verse 4. 5 and 12. And in every one of those cases, once with elders, the first two with elders, the third one with deacons, all of them have to do with managing a house, managing a family. Now, certainly there's an administrative idea to that, a managing of a household so that there is not chaos. But you know, we don't think of fathers, do we, in a heavy-handed fashion. As fathers lead their homes, they lead by love, they lead by care. They lead by sacrifice. They lead by laying down their lives. And so when Paul says they must rule well, he's not saying that they manage the church in a harsh and an efficient way even. He is saying they shepherd the people of God. They love the people of God. They lay down their lives. Like the good shepherd of John chapter 10, they lay down their lives for the sheep. And so we may get the wrong idea from rule, and we may get the wrong idea from rule well. I mean, what does Paul mean? What is the standard? How do we know when a particular minister of the gospel is ministering well? I mean, we may have in our minds some kind of comparison. You know, we need, you know, the kind of the Christian version of Steve Jobs at Apple. I mean, maybe somebody that is really efficient, somebody that is really effective, somebody that's really successful. Maybe that's what Paul means by rule well. Well, actually, the word that is used here, the word that is used for well, is not a comparative word. I mean, there are other words in the New Testament where that speaks of comparison. This is a word that just speaks of goodness or rightness, of meeting a certain standard. And so I say that simply say that Paul here is indicating that we ought to evaluate not based on this, against this person or against this particular standard, but simply, are they faithful? In and of themselves, are they doing what they ought to be doing? And I think we don't have to go any further than this particular book to look and say, what does it mean for a minister of the gospel to be successful? What does it mean for a minister of the gospel to be faithful, for one who rules well? I think we see it in, particularly in chapter 3. He must be above reproach. He must manage his household well. He must hold sound doctrine. He must point out error. He must be an example to the flock. Is he a faithful minister of the gospel? So he must rule well, but not only must he rule well in the church, he must labor diligently in the Word. In order to get that kind of double honor, he must labor diligently in the Word. Now, I'm not going to go excessively at this point. I think what Paul is indicating, and what we all know, that certainly those that give themselves to preaching and teaching, it is not the only thing that they are called to do. It's not just, you know, they read their Bible 168 hours a week and pray, you know, 168 hours a week, you know, along with that. That's not the idea. Certainly it is the idea that they are giving themselves to a lot of the time. A lot of their work is given indeed to the ministry of word and prayer. In fact, I think that the translation here in verse 17 may kind of throw us off the scent if we're not careful, because I believe the better way to translate here in verse 17, you may look at your text again, let the elders who rule well be considered worthy of double honor. That word especially there, it could be, and I think it's better to be translated, that is. In other words, those that rule well in the church, that is, in other words, those that labor in preaching and teaching of the word. So there's almost an identification between those that are ruling well. In fact, I think there is an identification. Those that are ruling well are the same ones, in fact, who are laboring and preaching and teaching in the Word. And so my prayer is then that God would give us grace to continue to esteem the Word of God, to esteem the Word of God in such a way that then we honor those who give themselves to it. So we honor, first, we honor elders with generous provision. And then number two, we protect all elders from unfounded accusations. Verse 19, we protect all elders from unfounded accusations. Verse 19, do not admit a charge against an elder except on the evidence of two or three witnesses. Now, I want to put forward a couple of cautions, a couple of warnings here as we look at this particular verse. First of all, we should not be surprised when elders are accused. We shouldn't be surprised when elders are accused. Now, I think at the beginning, when I say that at the beginning, that may sound a little counterintuitive. It may seem kind of the opposite of what we would expect. I mean, if these are elders, these are men who are above reproach, 1 Timothy chapter 3, if these are men who are above reproach, it would seem that there would be fewer accusations, fewer allegations against those kinds of people. But I think for anybody that's been close to pastoral ministry for any stretch of time, you realize that that is actually not the case, that it is the case that the very nature of pastoral work, the things that you have to get involved with, the sticky, sometimes messy, and definitely sinful situations that you have to be involved in, the stand that you must take for truth, the satanic attacks that are certain to come your way. All of these, I think we can cite other reasons why it is that elders, those that lead in the church, are more often, more frequently the target of accusation than perhaps other people in the congregation. Calvin said, none are more exposed to slanders and insults than godly teachers. They may perform their duties correctly and conscientiously, yet they never avoid 1,000 criticisms. Which then leads us to the second point. What should we do? We should then be cautious when elders are accused. Accusations are going to come. We should not be surprised. And therefore, we should be cautious when elders are accused. Paul says, notice very clearly, and I think this we just need to kind of read this and accept what he's saying here. Verse 19, we don't admit a charge against an elder except on the evidence of two or three witnesses. If there is not that, then we simply dismiss it. We just don't listen to it. Now, I'm not saying that we should stonewall or we should dismiss out of hand or that we should ignore serious allegations. But it does mean that we must take the utmost care and consideration when elders are accused. You say, well, shouldn't we do that with everybody? I mean, why do elders get that special treatment? Why is there really, it seems, favoritism in that case toward those that are laboring and preaching and teaching? Shouldn't we be kind of careful when anybody is accused? Well, I think the reason that Paul says this, it has to do with the public nature, the public office of the elder. And what I mean by that, think about, to give you an illustration, maybe throw a little bit of light on what I think Paul is getting at here. Think about over a decade ago, there was the Clinton scandal, Clinton affair, Clinton impeachment, all that stuff. You know, there was, after all the dust settled and the facts were kind of known and it was moving along in the process, there began to be a debate in our nation about whether or not a public official like the President of the United States could perform in his office in light of moral failings. So in other words, the argument was that there is a distinction between someone's public office, their public function, their ability to do the job, and a separation between that and their private life, that those are disconnected. And I certainly don't intend to settle that dispute in terms of presidential politics or whatever. I do intend to remind us, though, that separation between public office, public function, what an elder does, and his private life obviously has no place in the Bible. Those two are wed. And so why is it that Paul is so zealous to guard the reputation of an elder? It is simply because an elder simply cannot function. He cannot be an example to the people of God if the people of God do not believe in him both publicly and privately. Which then leads us, I think, by way of application. Let us be always zealous, always eager to do whatever we can to protect the reputation of those that preach and teach, those that labor in the word, those that lead us in the church. Not because they are some special class of super Christians, but because, more importantly, because the church is the pillar and buttress of truth. And we don't want that undermined in any way. We don't want the glory of God diminished in any way. We don't want the gospel to be hindered in its advance in any way. And it will be if people in the church or in the community do not believe in that person personally. And so let's be eager to eliminate, by God's grace, unfounded accusations. Be eager to stop unhelpful and ungodly criticism that simply brings down the reputation of those that labor in the ministry of the word. So Paul gives two admonitions, I think, to the congregation in particular and in its relationship to the elder. One, to honor faithful elders. Two, to protect all elders in terms of their reputation. And then he proceeds, number three, to encourage us to rebuke unrepentant elders in the presence of all. So Paul goes on. He doesn't just say, don't listen if there are accusations. He says, need to make sure that it's substantiated, that there are two or three witnesses, that there is credible evidence. And when there is credible evidence, he says, we go here in verses 20 and 21. As for those who persist in sin, rebuke them in the presence of all, so that the rest may stand in fear. And I take that rest, I think, to mean the rest of the congregation, not just the rest of the elders. Verse 21, in the presence of God and of Christ Jesus and of the elect angels, I charge you to keep these rules without prejudging, doing nothing from partiality. Now again, I think, what does he mean? I mean, we can immediately run into a thousand different applications, how this might look as it plays out in the life of the church. And so I want to urge us to be careful as we think through what it would look like to apply these particular verses. I'll give you an example. I don't think Paul here is saying, for example, that every little sin, obviously all sin is sin, and so I'm not belittling sin. I'm saying I don't think that Paul is saying every single sin is then worthy of a public rebuke in the congregation. I don't think that's what he's getting at. So I'll give you kind of an example. If two or three of you, two or three witnesses, all right, if two or three of you are driving somewhere in Birmingham this week and you see me jaywalking, all right, I don't think necessarily that calls for then a public rebuke in the presence of all. Now that I know that we probably have law enforcement brothers and sisters in here, and you realize the dangers of jaywalking much more carefully than we do. And so I'm not belittling jaywalking; it's wrong, it's sinful. Period. All right. But I am saying that I think there is something here that Paul is indicating that there needs to be sort of a bigness to it. There needs to be a magnitude to what we are talking about. And I'm not being prescriptive as to what it is that deserves a public rebuke or not. Certainly congregations can try to determine that as best they can under the leadership of the Spirit. But I am saying that I think that he's saying those sins, to kind of put it in the context of 1 Timothy, I think it is those sins that would discredit that individual in terms of his ability to be an example to the flock. And so if there is something of such a magnitude that he can no longer serve as an example to the flock in the ways that we looked at 1 Timothy chapter 3 and other places in the Bible, then I think that calls for a public rebuke if they are not repentant. That's why the ESV says that they persist in sin. If there is a pattern of unrepentance in their life, and there is the sin, or there is a sin of such magnitude, those kinds of situations. Again, I'm not being prescriptive. I don't know exactly what this always looks like. But in those kinds of circumstances, Paul says we rebuke them in the presence of all. And why would we do that? I mean, that seems so backwards, you know? It seems so inefficient and disruptive to, I mean, why not just kind of push them out, you know, or just kind of sweep them to the side and we just kind of go on? Why would we do that? Well, I think for a couple of reasons. One, we should rebuke as a witness to the truth. We rebuke as a witness to the truth. Look at verse, I take this from verse 21. In the presence of God and of Christ Jesus. I mean, do you hear, or do you feel, maybe is a better way to say it, do you feel the magnitude of what Paul is saying here? In the presence of God and of Christ Jesus and of the elect angels, I charge you to keep these rules without prejudging. You know Timothy had personal relationships. No doubt in the context of this book, there are false teachers who are disrupting the church and who are calling, and Paul is implicitly calling for their public rebuke. And no doubt Timothy has some relationships with them. And Paul says, I don't care how painful it is. I don't care how difficult it is. I am charging you in the presence of God and of Christ Jesus and of the elect angels to keep these rules without prejudging, showing no partiality, either favoritism or its opposite. Why do we do that in the church? We do that because as the pillar and buttress of truth, which is what we are called in 1 Timothy chapter 3, it is our desire and our need to align ourselves with the judgment of God. To align ourselves with the judgment that is sure to come, either now or on the last day. And so Paul is saying, if we're not going to deny our very identity as the pillar and buttress of truth, we must align ourselves with the truth of God, with the judgment of God. We do it as a witness to the truth, no matter how difficult, no matter how painful. And two, we do it. We should rebuke as a warning to others. So often the Bible motivates through grace. Things like Galatians 5:1, where Paul says, you know, for freedom Christ has set you free. Stand firm, therefore, in that freedom. And so there is this idea of grace motivating us, the gospel motivating us in all avenues of obedience. But you know, that is not the only way that the Bible motivates. Sometimes the Bible motivates by grace, sometimes the Bible motivates through fear. And this is one of those cases. Why is it that we do that? Well, he says it in verse 20. Those who persist in sin, rebuke them in the presence of all. And you might want to circle this or underline, so that the rest, and again, I believe he's speaking about the whole congregation. I can't be certain about that, but I think that's what he means. So that the rest may stand in fear, so that other people may look, other elders in particular, may look on that public rebuke and say, may it never be with me. I don't want that. My parents were big believers in firm and frequent discipline. And I have three older brothers, twin brothers that are 5 years older than me, and an oldest brother that's 7 years older than me. And so I saw a lot of their stuff. I saw a lot of that firm and frequent discipline in their life. And my mother tells me that I was far and away, I received far and away fewer, we'll call them episodes of discipline, than my brothers did. Why is that? Well, it's because even sinners have common sense. You know? I mean, I don't want that. I don't want that to be the case in my life. And so God is giving us here then. He is motivating us by, I mean, this is great. Even though it's motivating through fear and a sense, it is still of grace. Because our natural instinct is to think that I will get away with this. And I'll never get caught, and there's never going to be a day of reckoning. And this verse serves kind of as a shock treatment to say, brother, there will be a day of reckoning, certainly on that last day, but it may come even sooner than you think, and it won't be in the privacy of your home. It will be in full view of everyone else. He says, rebuke them in the presence of all. God forbid that we would ever need to take that step. But if it ever comes to that, May God give us the courage to believe His Word and to do His Word, to trust that He has infinitely more wisdom than we do, that we may think that we have a better and more creative way to do that, but we are at the same time short-circuiting His very intentions in the church in being a pillar and buttress of truth. So God, give us the courage to obey what He says. We honor, we protect, we rebuke, and then last, we appoint. We appoint each elder with great care. We appoint each elder with great care. Verses 22 through 25. Read those with me again, if you would. Do not be hasty in the laying on of hands. And I think the better translation here is this is not a bad translation. It's just maybe to kind of bring it out. Do not be hasty in laying on of hands. I think that word nor, it could also be kind of and in so doing. So there's a connection between what he is saying in these two phrases. Do not be hasty in laying on of hands, and in so doing, then take part in the sins of others. We'll unpack that in just a moment. And so he says, keep yourself pure. And then verse 23, which I know many of you are drawn to like a moth to the flame. And so what is Paul saying here? What is he indicating here? I'll save you some time. I don't know. All right. I don't know exactly why Paul has this here. I think it's probably because he ends verse 22 with keep yourself pure. And so it really is a parenthetical remark. It is almost a footnote here. You know, we kind of do that sometimes when we're writing an email, for example, and you know, you're kind of going along and you just think of something. You know, if I don't put this in parentheses, if I don't go ahead and say this right now, I'm going to forget it. And so you just kind of go ahead and blurt it out, say it, close that parentheses and go on with your thought. I think that is what Paul is doing here. He's, perhaps Timothy has kind of given himself to an ascetic lifestyle, maybe beginning of chapter 4, maybe the background of that. And Paul is saying, brother, that's killing you. That you have serious medical issues. And, you know, if you want to be an elder for a long time, the best way is not by, in this case, abstaining. The best thing you can do is to use this wine as a medicine. And so I think he's urging that. So don't think that your purity is going to demand that in terms of just you know eliminating any kind of medicinal help, for example, that wine might provide. All right, that's all I'm going to say about that. All right, so verse 24, the sins. And the reason I say that, by the way, I want you to connect those two. I do want you to see verse 22. Do not be hasty in laying on of hands nor take part in the sins of others. Keep yourself pure. And then realize that verse 24 kind of picks that thought back up. All right, so those two are connected, where he says, the sins of some men are conspicuous going before them to the judgment. In other words, it's obvious, okay? In some brothers, it is obvious they should not have hands laid upon them, simply recognize that there's nothing spiritual about that laying on of hands. They should be recognized as leaders in the congregation, as elders in the congregation, because their sins are so obvious. They're conspicuous. On the other hand, he says, but the sins of others appear later. So you're going to make mistakes. Sometimes it's not going to be so obvious. Now, obviously, I think the implication that he's making here is that you need to take all the time and all the care and all the due diligence that you can and make sure to the best of your ability. He says, the sin of others appear later, so also good works, he says, are conspicuous. Even those that are not cannot remain hidden. So I think the point is fairly clear that he's urging Timothy not to be hasty in laying on of hands, to be careful, okay? To be careful in the way he does it, because it's not always immediately obvious who should be or who should not be an elder. Why is this so important? Two quick reasons. First of all, careful selection, one, is for the benefit of those choosing. Again, verse 22, don't be hasty in laying on of hands, and in so doing, take part in the sins of others. In other words, he's saying, Timothy, you can't just go and lay hands on a particular brother and say he should be an elder doing this in haste, and then when he falls because you didn't do the due diligence that you should, say, you know what, I had nothing to do with that. It's not my fault. It's not my responsibility that he fell. No, he says there is a culpability, a responsibility that attaches to your laying on of hands. And I think that's a word for us whenever we appoint elders. At every step along the process, we need to realize there's a responsibility that goes along with setting apart people for leadership. So it's for the benefit of those that are choosing. And number two, it is for the protection of the church. for the protection of the church. And I think this one's fairly obvious. There's always a need for more elders. There's always a need for people to be raised up. But the last thing that we need to do, the last thing we need is haste in making those decisions. We're not always going to make the right decisions. Sometimes we're going to be wrong. Sometimes we're going to deny brothers who we shouldn't deny, and sometimes we're going to allow brothers that we shouldn't. That's just the nature of it. But we need to make sure that we do everything that we can on our part to minimize those mistakes, to make every effort to follow the word, to appoint godly men, and in so doing, to protect the church. Now, how do we do that? How do we, kind of backing up when, maybe to the entire sermon in a sense, how do we honor, how do we protect, how do we rebuke, how do we in this last case appoint in such a way that is consistent with the text? Maybe even to think about it this way, how do we avoid, because I think this may be the biggest danger for us when we look at this particular text, how do we avoid indifference to all of this? I mean, I know that there are a lot of you here tonight that you came tonight and you said, man, I really hope that he delves into pastor compensation, you know? I mean, that's just been gnawing at me all week. No, I suspect that there are, in your mind, bigger issues. There are more critical, more pressing issues in your mind. Things that are going on in your life, things that are going on maybe in your marriage, or things that are going on with your kids, or things that are going on at work, or whatever. So how do we avoid indifference to this? Well, I think two ways. Number one, we remind ourselves of the glory of God in the church. We need to remind ourselves of the glory of God in the church, that even though these matters may seem trivial in our eyes, they are not trivial in God's eyes. Acts 20, verse 28, Jesus has bought the church with his own blood. Church of God is precious to God. Not just in and of itself, but because the church, as we referenced back in 3, 14, 15, and 16, because God intends to display the glory of God in the church. And if that is the case, how do we then do that? How do we stir ourselves up to realize the glory of God in the church? One, we sense the gravity of casually ignoring God's word. I won't camp out here just to simply say that there are a lot of commands in this passage. They are not suggestions. He says to honor, he says to protect, he says to rebuke, he says to appoint, and he means what he says. He says, do it. Obey the word. And number two, we see the glory on the positive side. Not just the negative, we see the positive side. We see the glory of rightly ordering Christ's church. We see the glory of rightly ordering Christ's church. You know, I know that many of us have all kinds of negative experiences, maybe baggage that we bring into here tonight in regards to the church, and we just can't imagine, in light of all the things that we've seen, all the abuses, maybe pastors that have exploited the congregation or congregations that have exploited pastors. How in this world can the church display the glory of God as messed up as the church is? I just want to remind you that that is not the way it has to be. And that is certainly not God's intention. God's intention is not for shepherds who exploit the sheep or for sheep who abuse the shepherd. God's intention is for a pastor, or pastors rather, who would lay their lives down for the flock, who would live among them and who would love them with the love of Christ, and then in response of congregation of sheep who would then love their shepherd, follow their shepherd, who would give generously to their shepherd, not reluctantly under compulsion, but because they love him, they love the word of God. That is the ground, brothers and sisters, that is the ground in which the gospel best flourishes. We want the gospel to advance. But we cannot see the gospel advance if we don't pay attention to the way that we order things around here, the way that we follow the word of God around here. You see, the end goal of this passage, the end goal of all of these passages, really in the middle of 1 Timothy, the end goal, for example, tonight, is not to have well-paid pastors or public rebukes. The end goal is the glory of God. The end goal is for the gospel to go forward from the church. If that is the case, then we need to sense the gravity of disobeying God's word and see the glory of rightly ordering the church according to God's word. And then last, we need to remind ourselves of the kindness of God in the gospel. How do we avoid indifference? We remind ourselves of the kindness of God in the gospel. How do we avoid disobedience even? How do we avoid pitfalls of gossip and allegations and suspicion and an atmosphere of mistrust? How do we foster an environment of love? Think about this as you're closing up. Think about this as we finish. How do we foster an environment in this church, the Church of Brook Hills? How do we foster an environment of love and forgiveness and charity and unity from those that are leading to those that are led and from those that are being led to those that are leading? There's only one way we get there, brothers and sisters, and that is through the gospel. And here's what I mean by that. As I was preparing this passage, preparing this sermon, I was overwhelmed by my need for the gospel to lead in His church. Brothers and sisters, I need the gospel to deliver me from self-centeredness. I need the gospel to deliver me from desire for shameful gain. I need the gospel to deliver me from laziness. I need the gospel to deliver me from a sense of entitlement. I need the gospel to deliver me, and we could go on and on and on, all manner of sin. I need the gospel to deliver me. And at the same time, by the same token, you need the gospel. You need the gospel to deliver you from criticism. You need the gospel to deliver you from the spirit that would seek to bring about disunity in the church. You need the gospel to deliver you in all ways that are inconsistent with this passage. You need the gospel, and I need the gospel. We all need the gospel.